Starting a series, and we are getting ready for the Easter season. And so we want to talk to you about the Jesus you never knew. There is an interesting story about this newlywed couple. They just got married. They were so excited. Their names were Scott and Leslie. They were on their way to the honeymoon, and when they arrived, in the wee hours of the night, they came to this hotel. It was a luxurious hotel. It was going to be a bridal suite. And when they got to the room, they found a sofa, a chair, and a table. Well, but there was no bed. And so after several minutes, they discovered that the sofa was a fold-out bed. And so they spent a fitful night tossing and turning on this lumpy mattress with springs. We've all slept on those before, right? And with their honeymoon night room, Scott stormed to the front desk to give the clerk a piece of his mind. And he said, "There must be a mistake," the clerk said. He said, after checking the reservation, he said, "You know what, did you open the door to the bedroom?" And so Scott goes back to the room. He opens the door that he thought led to a closet, and he discovered the bedroom to the bridal suite. Inside was a king-size bed with a fruit basket, a box of chocolates, and a dozen roses. Completely available, yet totally unused. You know, sometimes in life we have to open certain doors in our lives. And when we talk about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we go through Easters. But I want this to be an Easter that it really applies to our life, that we grow in Christ closer and closer to Him. Because when we do that, our lives are blessed. When we follow the center of His will, it's not always easy, but it is a blessed life. And so some doors are too important to leave closed. We see this with early Christians. On that first Easter, they were behind locked doors. They were huddled together, fearing for their lives. Jesus had just been killed, and they thought that they were next. They walked into the room defeated, but they walked out dynamic. They walked into the room crushed, but they walked out confident. They walked in having a pity party. They walked out ready to conquer the world. They walked into the room paralyzed by fear, and they walked out filled with a dynamic faith. If you look on the very first verse on your outline, I want to read this verse, but let me say this. There are six events that took place within 12 hours. They're significant because all of history is split by what happened in that 12-hour period of time. People still talk about it. Movies are still made about it. The six events that took place in Jesus' life was he was betrayed by Judas, he was forsaken by his friends, he was denied by his followers, he was tried by his accusers, tortured by the Roman guards, and crucified by his enemies. Why did God allow these six events? Why did Jesus go through all the suffering? Why did he subject himself to a grueling, gruesome, horrendous, brutal death? And the question today is, what really happened on the cross? And if I really get what happened on the cross, how does it change the way I live? Look at the first verse, John 3:16-17, the most famous book in all the Bible, famous verse. It says this, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him." So this morning, I want to understand that God's compassion for you. Listen, God loves you. If you can remember the very worst day you've ever had, the worst day you've ever been. Anybody remember that? Don't you hate those days? And then you take the very best day you've had. Maybe you're in love with the Lord and all these things. Let me say this. God loves you. It's not based upon your performance. God loves you at your worst day. God loves you at your best day. He just loves you. God loves you. He has a compassion for you, a compassion of love for each and every one of us. For God so loved the world that he gave of himself and allowed himself to be nailed to a cross that we might have eternal life. Number one, write this down. The cross is a place of redemption. The cross is a place of redemption. The cross was there to redeem us to the Lord. Max Lucado wrote a book about the cross called No Wonder Why They Call Him Savior. The cross rests in the center of time. History has idolized the cross and yet despised it. The cross has been gold-plated and also been burned. The cross has been worn and yet trashed. History has done everything to the cross except for ignore it. The cross is a pivotal point in history, and it should be a pivotal pit. Say that with me. A pivotal point in our lives. Redemption takes place at the cross. Look at this in John 19:25. He says this, "But standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene." It is a great story. Mary Magdalene, in this story, was one of the least likely characters in the New Testament to receive redemption. Raise your hand if you ever feel like you're the least likely to receive redemption. Raise your hand if you think the person next to you is the least likely. No. We read that Mary Magdalene was a woman from whom Jesus had cast out seven demons. These seven demons made her do terrible things. She had been in bondage for a long time. Satan was at work in her life, trying to destroy her emotionally, physically, spiritually. She was a woman from the streets, and in short, Mary was in a hopeless and a helpless situation, but Jesus delivered her and set her free. How many of you have ever felt like you're in a hopeless and a helpless situation? Yes, listen, there is nothing too big for God. The Bible says there is nothing too impossible for the Lord. The same resurrection power that raised Jesus from the dead that helps us in our helpless and our hopeless situations of life. Look why he came in Acts 26:18. It says this, "To open their eyes so that they may turn from darkness to light, and from the dominion of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among those who have been sanctified by faith in me." Listen, redemption is costly. For me to receive forgiveness, Jesus had to be made sin for me and die in my place. The Bible says that the wages of sin is what?
Death.
So the payment for sin is death. But the free gift of God through Jesus Christ, we have eternal life. So the wages of sin is death. We all should have died for our sins, but Jesus was the scapegoat. He was a substitute for us. He who knew no sin became sin. The wrath of God's judgment came upon him for all of our sins, all the shame, all of our guilt. And it was nailed to a cross, and Jesus was a sacrifice for our sin. The wages of sin is death, and Jesus became that death for us. So you and I could be redeemed. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And then when Jesus was on the cross, he went through a trial, he went through all the suffering, he went through all the scourging, he was nailed to a cross. And Jesus said, "It is finished." And in that moment of agony, Jesus Christ calls out, "It is finished." He wipes sin away from us, those who believe. And then number two, understanding God's compassion for you, the cross is a place of relationship. It's a place of relationship. It's so great that we can have a relationship with the Lord. There was a gentleman that came to our church. He was a pastor for many years, retired. He was a three-term mayor for Tulare. And I can remember one day, it was just me and him, and we were sitting in his living room, and I think you become real wise when you get older. And he was one of those guys that the things he said, he would just speak out wisdom. And he said, and I remember him saying this one day, he says, Brian, he goes, I know the solution to everything. He goes, I've come to the end of my life, I've done this, and I realize the solution to everything is not the right religion, it's the right person. The solution to everything is Jesus Christ. If you need healing, he's our healer. Every need that you and I have in life has to do with all the names of God in the Old Testament. The fulfillment of that in Jesus Christ. One day, you and I will be measured up to the perfection of the law. See, the law is perfect in every way, except the law cannot save you. So the law shows us that you and I are in need of a Savior because we can't fulfill the law. Jesus came to fulfill the law, to pay the penalty of death, and then he rose again that we can have a relationship with him. Look at this verse in John 19, 26 and 27. He says it this way, when Jesus then saw his mother and disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, behold your mother. And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own household. See, that was John, the beloved. And John was there and he said, John, basically take care of my mother. Mother, this is your son. And it's like he's saying, we are all related together. Have you ever been to a place where you met somebody and you had that commonness of the blood of Jesus running through you? And it's like you knew that person for your whole life. Well, we have that commonness, don't we? We are all related by the blood of Jesus Christ. Look at what this says in Romans 12, 4 and 5. For just as we have many members in one body, and all the members do not have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ and individually members one of another. So everybody in this room, we all belong to the body of Christ. The body of Christ, Christ had a plan and a purpose to die on the cross for us. We have a plan and a purpose of what as well, to go out and to preach the gospel. We should have a ministry inside the church. We all have a ministry outside the church. And so we are all related. We're one body with many members. And then number three, the cross is a place of responsibility. It's a place of responsibility. John firsthand got that when he was there at the cross, he had a responsibility that Jesus gave him to take care of his mom. You and I have a responsibility. We all have a plan and a purpose in our lives. You have a greater plan and a purpose in your life than most times we think. God has a bigger plan than you could ever imagine. Look what it says in John 20, 21. It says this, so Jesus said to them again, peace be with you, as the Father has sent me, I also send you. Guess what God's redemption plan is? He sends us. He sends us into the world. He sends us to our co-workers and our friends and our family, that we might witness to them, that we might share the love of Jesus. So we all have a responsibility in the kingdom of God. Just like one body has different functions, right? The ears hear, the eyes see, the mouth speaks. There's different functions, and there's different functions in the body of Christ. And so understanding God's compassion for you, we see the cross is a place of redemption, it's a place of relationship, it is a place of responsibility. And then responding to God's passion for you. Responding to God's passion for you. There is a new confidence towards God. There should be a new confidence for you in God, listen, in His love. There's nothing, the Bible says, that can separate you from the love of God. There's nothing too wide, too deep, too long that can separate us from the love of God. Is that good news? Amen. Because we need God's love. It is His kindness that leads us to repentance. 1 John 4:19 says, "We love because he first loved us." And we have a video clip. How many of you have seen the movie Risen? How many of you have heard of the movie Risen? How many have no idea what I'm talking about? Anyway, right? That's okay. There's a movie out. I challenge you to go see it. It's a good movie. It's called Risen. Go to Tulare because they have cool, comfortable seats. And check it out. But go ahead. We're going to show a little clip of one of the disciples here.
Who's following you?
I am he.
Bring him. What you have to win? By spreading fantasy.
By mine own eyes, Jupiter. I walked with him. He spoke to me. It's unbelievable. It is so.
And touch my blood. Well, no. Or show me the body.
You must shed your sins. God is not at my beck and call.
God, Yahweh, manifests himself through a crazy, poor, dead Jew.
Well, so it appears.
What does this rebirth mean?
Eternal life. For everyone. Everyone who believes.
God is recruiting to him. Much better than the salt. And we are.
Well, we are few for now. And our only weapon is love.
Isn't that great? Our only weapon is love. We discover our value at the cross. When we really get the message of the cross, we become confident in God's love. Again, we love because he first loved us. He loves us. He's committed to us. As I said, it doesn't matter those things in life, those things that we regret, God takes those and he nailed them to a cross. It does not give us a license to do those things that are wrong. Paul said, may it never be. But there is a new confidence toward God. And you can see in the movie, there's a new confidence in the disciples after they left the upper room. Do you know why they had great confidence? Because they saw Jesus face to face. They saw Jesus face to face. Thomas was there, and he says, I don't believe in Jesus, unless I could see the nail scars in his hand or in his feet, I won't believe. And Jesus kind of walks through a wall. And he says, Thomas, and Thomas falls to the ground. He says, Thomas, blessed are you who see and believe. But even more blessed are those who, even though they don't see, yet they believe. See, in our society, seeing is believing. But in God's economy, believing is seeing. And if I ask if you believe, then you have seen. It is a great thing that we see what took place in the disciples. Look what it says in 1 Peter 1, 3-5. He says this, blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed at the last day. We are members of God's own family. We have a new confidence because of his love for us. It is the Lord that showed up, that they saw him face to face. And then write this down, a new confidence towards God in his grace. A new confidence in his grace. What does grace mean? It means this, unmerited favor. It's something you can't earn. It's something that God gives to you. You've heard me say this many times that I looked out through the three services today and I noticed when people were walking in and leaving, there was a symbol of the cross. And it would be really weird back in the Bible days if anybody ever wore a cross because it was such a heinous symbol. It was such a despised symbol of torture that people wouldn't dare wear a cross. But because that cross is touched by God's grace, it has now become a symbol of that of beauty. The cross is a symbol of beauty. And when the Lord touches things, just like he touched the cross and turned it into something of beauty, you know what? He touches our lives, the recesses of our lives, the good, the bad, and the ugly of our lives, and he touches it and makes something of beauty out of it. We have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. There is great value in us because of Jesus Christ. The Bible says, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. See, Satan is terrified of believers because Christ resides in us. This is the temple of God. He's inside of our hearts and in our lives. The enemy, listen, wants to bring out the very worst in your life. The enemy wants you to make bad decisions and bad decisions and bad decisions. Jesus wants to bring the very best out of your life, that you would follow in the center of your center of his will, no matter how convenient it is. But we do it out of faith. So we see that not only does he give us confidence in love, but also in his grace. Look what it says in Hebrews 4, 15 and 16. He says this, "For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in all things, as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, let us draw near with confidence." Say that with me, confidence. "To the throne of grace, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in the time of need." Look at, if you're going through struggles, how many of you are going through struggles? Come on, be honest with me. All right. Pray. God loves you so much, he wants to hear from you. The Lord loves you so much, when you invite him, he will intervene in your life. He will intervene in your situation because of love that he has. Because of love, because of his grace. Listen, his grace, his mercy is brand new how often? Every day. It never runs out. My bank account at some point runs out. Right? You have a beginning and an end of your bank account. And some of it's pretty close. But God's bank account for his mercy and grace, it never ends, it never fails. It is always there for us. And then we have a great confidence in his power working through me. Listen, the same resurrection power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead is the same resurrection power available for us in life, in struggles, in death. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Acts 1:3 says this, "To these he also presented himself alive after his suffering." Let me say that again. "To these, he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over a period of," say with me, 40 days, "and speaking of the things concerning the kingdom of God." So after Jesus' resurrection, he was appearing to people for 40 days. And people are going, "Isn't that the guy that was nailed to the cross?" And that's why people believe. That's why the disciples were willing to give their lives in death. All the disciples except for John was martyred for their faith. Listen, if it would have been like the Jews said that the disciples stole the body, how many of you know you're going to give your life for truth, but you ain't going to give your life for a hoax? If they stole the body, they would have never given their lives up. But because they met Jesus face to face, because they believed, they saw. Because we believe, we see him also. The power working through me. And then number two, not only do we have a confidence toward God, we have a new compassion towards people. We have a new compassion for people. 2 Corinthians 5:19 says it this way, "Namely that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against him." Do I hear an amen to that one?
Amen.
"And he has committed to us the word of reconciliation." And as Christ reconciles us, we are called to be reconciled with others. It is an understanding of God's compassion for us through redemption, through the relationship we have through Him, through the responsibility that He's called all of us to be sent to this world. It is a new confidence towards God in His love, in His grace, and in His amazing power working in us. Look at, you are more than conquerors. You're going through a situation in life, rise above it. It is the power of Christ in you. Be obedient to God's word and have a new compassion for others. I love Easter time. I love Easter time because we serve a risen Savior that is alive today. If you're here with us on Easter, I always tell this story. I absolutely love the story. It's a favorite story, and I've probably worn it out, but bear with me, okay? I'm getting old. When you get old, you repeat yourself more. How many people? It's a story of this father and son driving in the car in the country. And they were driving through. The son was highly allergic to bee stings. The window was only open that much. But if this bee would have stung this kid, it could cost him his very life. So when that bee came in the window, how many of you know, he freaked out a little bit. So he jumps in the back seat. The father reaches out and he grabs the bee. He says, "Son, don't worry, I got the bee." So he comes back in the front seat and he says, "Son, it's okay." And he opens his hand and the bee flies away. And he gets all crazy again. He jumps in the back seat. He says, "No, son, look at my hand. I took the stinger for you. That bee can no longer hurt you." And Jesus says to us on the cross, the wages of sin is death. And he says to us, "Son's daughter, don't worry. Look at me. I took the stinger for you. Death, where's your sting? Death, where's your victory? It's been nailed to the cross, and Jesus rose again, and we will all rise with him. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord." I hope you guys are excited about this stuff, because it's good stuff. God loves you. That's a miracle in itself, isn't it? That God chooses to love us. Look at, God chooses to love us. Let me say this. Love is a choice. Husbands, love your wives. It's a choice. Wives, love your husbands. It's a choice. We get to love God. It's a choice. He loves us. I love what he says in that. The only weapon we have is love. Isn't that great? God loves us so much. Pastor Ken is going to come. He's going to lead us in prayer, lead us in communion this morning. God is good. God loves you. He loves you. And he loves you.